It was the thud heard round the world. Jamie just couldn't help but fall for Claire all over again. Yes, I went there, and before I keep going there, let's rewind and find out what things were like before Claire's return. Let's go. Hey guys, and welcome to Really Seriously For Real. This episode was a long time coming for show-only watchers and book readers alike. We hated to see Claire and Jamie apart almost as much as Claire and Jamie did. So to see Claire walk into the infamous print shop last week was big. No, actually, it was colossal. After the previously recap at the beginning of the show, if you thought you were about to start belting out "Sing Me a Song" in the intro, think again. They had a cold opening, meaning that they went right into the episode, no intro song right away, demanding that you paid attention to the scene at hand without delay, as if we needed convincing. Landing you right into the show from Jamie's perspective this time. This gave us a general idea of what life was like for our ginger hottie in those years since his departure from Hellwater. And we also get to see who this Geordi is just before Jamie sends him off on an errand. Jamie even shows us how to use the print press as we observe his visual tutorial. Yes, Jamie has had a seemingly normal existence. Until Claire walks in. When Jamie comes to and sees Claire hovering over him, much like he imagined after the battle at Culloden, he even asks her if she was really there. It was a great moment because when you think about it, Claire has so much time to mentally prepare herself to see Jamie again. Yet even with that preparation, her mind is still running the gamut of possible outcomes. Jamie is now staring at the woman who left his life 20 years ago, a woman he believed he would never see again, or more so prepared himself to understand and believe that he would never see her again. And he tells her this and asks her if she's real. The time they took with the initial meeting was perfect. Jamie's awkwardness around Claire, the mild realization that they're still married, Jamie taking her hand and looking deep into her eyes, being immediately drawn to her lips, pausing instead to ask for Claire's permission for a kiss, as if he really needed it. He told her anytime he needed her, he would see her, but she never touched him. Claire responds that he could touch her now. It was so satisfying. I was smiling ear to ear. That is until Geordi abruptly interrupts the reunion, shouting, "I quit," citing Jamie's appearance and more. After Geordi storms out, Jamie and Claire head to the back of the shop so he can retrieve more pants because he had spilt water on them when he fell to the floor. Now that the initial shock wore off, he finally remembered they have a child. So Claire hands him photos that she brought along, and Jamie whips out his glasses. It was so cool because he was like, "I need glasses for reading." And Claire is like, "My hair is actually gray." Each of them aged, and it was kind of like, okay, this is who we are now. No big deal. So Jamie started flipping through the pictures, and my heart was just melting. This is the first time Jamie could see a child that he had with Claire. Even Faith, all he had was Claire's description. Now he had lifelike pictures recounting the years and milestones of his daughter. Although I personally thought she could have left out the bikini photo. I mean, that is her dad after all. It's a little awkward. Claire tells him her name is Brianna, after his father Brian. Jamie doesn't actually like the name initially, but he got over it. When he asks what Brianna's first words were, I was like, please don't say it was dad, because that could be awful. Very awkward. But Claire said it was dog, and then no. I know about that one. During the exchange, Claire tells him that she's a surgeon, and he's like, "You already were. Now you have the title. I love it. Like, you know, you had this in the bag. No need to worry." It was such a tender and special moment. While he continued to flip through the pictures, my only criticism was that I wanted the moment to stay on Brianna a little longer, because that was his only child with Claire, so I wanted more questions and more reflection. You know, after all, Brianna did say, "You gotta go over there because you need to tell him all about me." But instead, he abruptly stops and hands her back the photos, which is like, oh shoot, what's going on? And then he walks over to the mantle. He reveals that he has a son and shows Claire, well, I guess not a picture, but a painting. Now, since I'm still reading the books, I don't bring the book's content into my reviews, since I'm technically reviewing the shows. I'm not reviewing the books. Okay, this is a book spoiler, just in case. Okay. In the books, Jamie doesn't tell Claire about Willie for quite some time and finds out eventually, and that leads to a lot of problems between the two of them. Now, while I don't particularly think Jamie should feel the need to hide Willie from Claire, I simply wish there was more time spent learning about Brianna. I don't know. That's just me. What did y'all think? I'm curious. In any case, Claire was curious about his son, and he gave her his description and tells him she knew before coming that he would have had a life. And Jamie, he asks about Frank, and she explains that he died a few years ago, helping to establish a timeline as well. She tells him that he loved Brianna very much and was a good father to her. Soon after, Jamie realized that he was supposed to be somewhere, and they ventured through town and continue to catch up when all of a sudden, through the crowd, you hear, "Milady! Fergus!" Claire tells him he turned into a handsome young man, and his reply, of course, was, "I have. I just love this kid." Claire then sees his hand, which is now a metal replacement. Anyone who watches Game of Thrones, I'm getting Jaime Lannister vibes. Then came the big question, where have you been? Claire says she was in America, and she thought Jaime was dead and didn't want to jeopardize Lollybrock as the wife of a traitor. Fair enough, good story. Jamie and Fergus walk ahead a bit, and Fergus remarks how extraordinary her arrival is, but then says, what about leading Jamie to talk about Ned to advise him on the law? I think I know why the writers opted not to take the book version of Willie's reveal, because there are bigger things going on in Jamie's life that he hasn't told Claire. And I guess they felt like, let's not complicate the story any further, or the reunion any further. So they head into the tavern, and we meet Mr. Willoughby, who is being knocked around by a woman for licking her elbows. Yes, I said licking her elbows. Mr. Willoughby is going to be very interesting. Jamie introduces Claire as Mrs. Malcolm. Ah, I had goosebumps. But what's more interesting is that Jamie leaves Claire with him to disappear into the bowels of the establishment for a cloak and dagger exchange with an unsavory gentleman. Outlander wasted no time to get the adventure queued up for the rest of the season. When Jamie retrieves Claire, he takes her further down the street where any man would take his soulmate after not seeing each other for 20 years, a brothel. The madam gives Jamie a kiss on each cheek, and you realize this is the same woman that appeared in the first frame of the episode helping Jamie to look presentable before heading to work. By the way, thank you, madam, because he looked perfect for Claire. Anyway, Jamie introduces Claire as his wife, and the madam is all like, wife? What? How could you bring her to such an establishment? Like, I'm so sure you're so concerned about Claire. It was very clear she was more concerned that Jamie was very much not on the market officially. Anyway, they go to his room, he and Claire. And Claire is like, okay, wait a minute. Why do you have a room in this place? And you hear people in different rooms engaging in, well, we'll say play, right? Jamie explains he only has a room there because it's an exchange of service. The madam is a customer of his, and he rooms there out of convenience because it's right across the way from the print shop. That's all. Jamie asks Claire, why was she there? And he asks several times. He was trying to understand if she was there for him or merely just to bring him word of his daughter. Which I think is kind of funny when you think about it, because it's not like she can, you know, like, you know what, let me hop over to the 1700s and just let him know about his kid and head back, you know, or start up a, you know, life in some village somewhere. It's a little difficult. So I thought it was a little funny, the fact that he was even asking, to be quite honest, or asking that question, to be quite honest. But he says that they know each other less now than they did when they were first wed. The wedding. He simply wanted to know if she wanted him. Well, duh. Of course she does, Jamie. Now let's kiss. All right, fine. Let's eat. It was really nice watching them getting to know each other over a meal. And then Jamie eventually asks if Claire would go to bed with him. Jamie, I thought you'd never ask. So they dove in, exchanging turns at disrobing each other while slyly staring into their eyes. After Jamie gets past her zippered corset, she's standing in front of him naked. And then she shyly covers up after he remains quiet. But he tells her that she's the most beautiful woman he's ever seen. After disrobing Jamie, they guide themselves to the bed, ready to unleash 20 years of built-up sexual anxiety. And after a few bumps and misstarts, they get their stride. And Claire growls, "Do me now and don't be gentle." You tell him, Claire. And with that, Outlander is reborn. Our couple is rechristened after 20 years, and they go on to christening that room until sunup. You go, guys. You're our heroes. All the while, though, they continue to explore each other and talk. Claire correctly observes that Jamie is involved in more than just printing. Jamie finally confesses that he smuggles liquor and stores it in the brothel, hence the convenient arrangement that he has there. Claire also observes a cut on Jamie's leg, which he says was from Culloden, but of course we know that was given to him by Blackjack before Jamie killed him. He didn't mention that part to Claire. In the morning, Jamie leaves Claire so he can tend to business. And later, a boy comes to the room looking for Jamie, and Claire asks him what his name was. He says Ian Murray, which Claire wonders if he was Jenny and Ian's son. And he is! She tells him she's his Aunt Claire. Ian was shocked because he had always heard that she was dead. And he also heard that she was a fairy. She tells him she's not a fairy, but tells him the story of her fleeing to the colonies after thinking Jamie was dead. Once Ian leaves, Claire ventures downstairs and chats with some of the girls as they eat breakfast. They mistake Claire for a new girl, and I personally think Claire didn't do a good job of trying to convince them otherwise. I kept worrying that they would be offended if they found out later. Which, when the madam came in, she immediately told Claire go up to her room and she'd have breakfast brought up. Claire gets to their room and finds a man rummaging through Jamie's things. She announces herself as his wife and let the trouble begin. See, nothing good ever happens when Jamie and Claire are separated at any point. Claire has barely been in town for 24 hours and she's already found trouble, or trouble found her. It was perfect. They gave the characters and the audience enough time to reflect on them, rediscovering themselves. It was perfectly done, I think. A little sprinkling of comedy, a few new character reveals, and the promise of problems to come. Fantastic. What was your favorite part of the famous reunion? comment down below. Mine was this. Thanks for watching. Until next time, guys.